Really, the main entree is we have a wonderful speaker tonight, Dr. John Pendergast, who's here. So please say hello.
Hello.
Hello, John. And,
hello. Hi, everyone.
John is the program director of Russian at West Point and associate professor of Russian. And he has a long history, including some time, if I read correctly, that you were out here in Monterey at the Defense Language Institute at one point. Another sign of good judgment. So we're delighted to have you back, if only in a virtual form. But we know you have a specialty in Russian music and Russian of the 19th and 20th centuries. And for those of you who, I'd be remiss in my duties if I didn't hold up a book and say that he's just written a book called Joan of Arc on the Stage and Her Sisters in Sublime Sanctity. So if any of you are feeling Amazon friendly, you can go online and find his book. So I'll give you a good plug for that.
Thank you.
We're delighted that you make time because you're 3 hours ahead and this is it's already 9 o'clock your time. So thanks so much for coming and also staying up probably a little bit late. So we're delighted to have you with us and the floor is yours.
Well, thank you very much.
One last thing. I can put up the little, I did not share because I didn't know who was coming, but I can put up that screen, the sheet that you shared me anytime you wish.
That's sure. Fine. I'm going to share my presentation. I use Teams more than I use Zoom. Is there a way to put that document into the chat screen to actually attach it?
You can actually share your screen, I think, Bettina, is that correct?
Yes.
Yes, and I'm going to do that, but I meant maybe I can just look here.
If it is a URL that you're talking about, you can post it in the chat. Go down to the chat button, click on the chat button, and at the very bottom text area, you can enter a URL, which will be clickable and people can go to in their own computer.
Right. It's not, unfortunately. I didn't think to make it a URL. Well, but I can share that as well. And but first, thank you, Slavyanka, for inviting me. Thank you, Paul Andrews, for suggesting this idea. I feel like I should tell folks that I came to know Paul through a little project that I'm working on with him and with Irina, translating a choral conducting technique book by Lev Pankratov about Lev Sivukhin, who are both from Russia as conductors. And so I'm working on that right now with them. My sort of beginning in music goes back a long way. I've sung in choirs all of my adult life, and I've directed some choirs as well. And I have a degree in music. That's sort of where I started. And then right after I finished that, I joined the Army, which I stayed in for 27 years. I started off at the Defense Language Institute in Russian. I then served in Germany as a listening to the Soviet forces in East Germany. I then worked as an interpreter on the Intermediate Nuclear Forces Treaty and the Conventional Armed Forces in Europe Treaty. Then did some other regular army time as a platoon leader in Korea and company commander at Fort Gordon in Georgia. I then was recruited by West Point to become a professor, well, a teacher of Russian first. That was back in about 2002. Eventually I retired from the Army and then finished my PhD and they hired me to be a professor. And as Paul just said, I was just promoted to associate professor and received tenure. So that's where we got to here. My master's thesis was on this very topic of Eugene Onegin. And what I'm gonna share, the first screen I'm gonna share with you is a little bit about that. Let's see. Are you seeing two pages of a Word document? Oh, probably not yet. Now are you seeing it?
Yes.
Yes.
Okay. So there's a couple of things to know about Eugene Onegin. Initially, it was written as a novel in verse by Alexander Pushkin from roughly 1823 to 1830. He worked on it a very long time and it came out in installments. So the opera develops from that. But there are so many connections between the two beyond just the fact that the sort of plot obviously is based on the same thing. And I just want to bring up a couple of points. Vladimir Nabokov, who is famous, of course, mostly for his novel Lolita, did a great deal of study of Pushkin and specifically Eugene Onegin. And he says that what Pushkin is trying to create is an evocation of Arcadia, the ideal sort of garden shepherdess kind of pastoral image when he sets part of the story in the countryside on the Larin estate. And what he sets up is a dichotomy that is very common in Russian literature of sort of the city versus the town. And the city always represents something that's kind of false and artificial and perhaps superficial, whereas the country is where the home is, where the heart is, where people are more genuine and sincere. That both of those things, of course, are stereotypes and not to be taken too far, but this is something that he sets up. And the poem, the novel in verse, is in essentially eight chapters, which Pushkin actually called cantos. And it starts off in St. Petersburg and it ends in St. Petersburg. And in between, you have at least one canto in Moscow. And in the center, you have this dream that Tatiana has, where she sees something terrible in her future. And a couple of the main events that happen in the story, you have this character Onegin, who is this sort of fop from St. Petersburg, and he's about to inherit an estate from his dying uncle. And so that's why he ends up in the country. And there he meets the Larins, who are a provincial family. And they have two daughters, Tatiana and Olga. And Tatiana immediately falls in love with Onegin. He's this ideal image of this person that she's perhaps seen in a novel. Her sister Olga is this very lively, pretty girl. And she's engaged to marry a man who is a poet who lives in the neighborhood. And who this gentleman is named Lenski, Vladimir Lenski. And Lenski and Onegin become friends. And so all of this is sort of set up as the story. At a certain point in the story, Tatiana sits down and writes a letter to Onegin declaring her love for him, which is a bit of a problem because in the pastoral, it's supposed to be the man who pursues the woman. And in this case, Tatiana has turned that on its head, and not surprisingly, things began to go badly. Onegin replies to Tatiana telling her, you know, you're lucky that you wrote this to me because some other guy might have taken advantage of this, but I'm not that kind of guy. I'm just going to tell you I'm not interested in you. And of course, she's crushed by this. And after that, there's a party where Tatiana, her birthday, sort of her birthday, it's technically her name day, is being celebrated. And at that party, out of sheer boredom, this St. Petersburg fop Onegin decides to flirt with Tatiana's sister, Olga, who, as I've already said, is engaged to be married to Lenski. And Lenski gets very jealous. And in the story, it's done slightly differently. He leaves the party and then sends a letter to Onegin declaring that he's upset about things and that he wants to challenge him to a duel. In Tchaikovsky's opera, all of that is changed, and all of this happens on the stage. And so they have a duel. And in that duel, Onegin actually kills Lenski. And then some time passes and Onegin disappears and Tatiana goes to first Moscow to be married and eventually ends up in St. Petersburg. While at a party that Onegin has gone to, he discovers that Tatiana has become this wonderful society lady. And realizes the mistake that he's made when he was in the country at her estate, and now he's in love with her. And he declares that he must be with her, even though she's now married. And she says, I will not do that. I'm married. I'm going to be true to my husband eternally. And in the poem, the novel in verse, it sort of ends right there. And we hear the clicking of Tatiana's husband's boots but that's the end of it. And Pushkin sort of makes a sort of a joke out of it a little bit. Obviously, you can't really do that on the stage. And so Tchaikovsky essentially has Tatiana turn him down, and then he declares that he's disgraced, and he has to find, you know, some other way to live the rest of his life. So that's sort of the story in a nutshell. But you have this Arcadia thing that comes up, in my opinion, and I think Nabokov also agrees. And it starts right from the very, very beginning. And I don't know how many of you do have these. Does anybody have these notes available to them? Paul, no?
Yes, no, nobody, no, it's not sent because I didn't, but it's on the screen.
Okay. Well, so there are some, I don't know how, I can share this another time, but what I'm going to play for you are a number of musical excerpts, which I believe set up all of what I've just described and show much closer connections between the characters than sometimes are understood when the opera is being watched, for example. So what I'm going to change to now is my presentation, but I think I have to stop sharing first. Let me see. First, stop share, because I have some sounds that I'm going to play for you as well. All right, let's see. Share sound. Okay, are you seeing? No, you're still seeing that, aren't you? Sorry. Let me stop that again. Here we go. Now I believe you're seeing my PowerPoint presentation, yes?
Yes.
Okay, very good. All right, so this is the presentation. It's essentially thinking about Pushkin's novel in verse being made into a novel in music by Tchaikovsky. And what we'll talk about a little bit is the text and textual changes that Tchaikovsky makes in turning the novel in verse into an opera. We'll talk about these musical compounds, these themes that come up throughout the opera, and they are like the leitmotif in Wagner, but not exactly the same. And I think you'll see how they're different after we've discussed them a bit. So I already kind of went through all of this. Your main characters are the St. Petersburg fop, Onegin, the country girls, Tatiana and Olga, sisters, and then Lenski, the poet. We have love triangles and jealousy, disgrace and death, all the great stuff for opera. Pushkin, in his treatment of the story, is very light and very often ironic. The tone of the poem is rather entertaining, and it's not unusual to laugh in certain parts. And it's amazing how Pushkin, in verse, can carry on even conversations between characters. It's truly an amazing literary achievement. And I've already mentioned a little about Nabokov's notes and ideas about that. Tchaikovsky decided to make an opera of Eugene Onegin around 1877. He alters the organization and the atmosphere. Onegin as an opera is almost unrelentingly very dark and very somber. The lightness and the irony are all gone. Instead of Onegin being the center of the story, Tatiana is absolutely the center of the story. And there are aspects of it that mirror his own life. I think it's no secret to anyone that Tchaikovsky was homosexual. Although in the very time that he was deciding to work on Eugene Onegin, he got married. Over the objections of his brother, over the objections of his friend, over his own sense of himself. And at one point, he decided that he would marry this woman. Her name was Milyukova, because she declared her love to him, and he didn't want to be like Eugene Onegin and break her heart. So there's this connection between the story that he's making an opera of and his own life, which I believe affects the way he decides to present the story. As I said, I wrote my thesis on this, and I'd studied that there are basically 1,000 lines in the libretto, most of which was put together by Tchaikovsky himself, at least in its final form. And at least 572 lines of the libretto are lifted directly from Pushkin's text. So it is, for that reason, quite close. You may see in my text here EOP and EOT. What I'm talking about there is Pushkin's Eugene Onegin versus Tchaikovsky's Eugene Onegin. And in fact, Tchaikovsky didn't call it an opera. He called it seven lyrical scenes, Lyrические сцены. So we'll go now, this idea of compounds, this is a term that Boris Asafiev came up with in his analysis of the work in 1972. The word he used was complexly, but the way he talks about it, it's not just complexes. They end up being almost like chemical compounds. And I realized as I was thinking about this recently that it reminds me a little bit of Goethe's elective affinities. I don't know if you've ever read that story, but he tells a story of these people whose interaction with each other is almost like chemical compositions and compounds, and that they almost don't have control over their behavior because of their connection to each other and just the effect that their interaction has on each other. And I think there's something possibly to this that is related to at least the way Tchaikovsky deals with these themes. So let's just dive right on into them. So the first one that I'm calling the Tatiana compound, we're going to hear it in the overture. It's a very, very distinct sequence of notes, which the overture plays with and develops and turns upside down and treats as a real theme. But I'm just going to play the very first two iterations of that. And so here's what they sound like. I hope you can hear this. Please let me know if you have any trouble hearing it. Okay, so, and that goes on and develops and modulates and does a lot of other things. But it's a short introduction. He doesn't even call it an overture because it is quite brief. And it goes right into a duet. And it just happens that this duet is a poem also by Pushkin, but not at all related to Eugene Onegin. But it is absolutely a pastoral poem. It is called Pivets, which means something like bard or singer. And at the moment where that theme comes back, the Tatiana compound theme, the two sisters are singing about the sound of the panpipe in the countryside. Svireli zvuk unilii prastoi, the sound of the panpipe, sort of melancholy and simple. So this summoning of the idea of Arcadia and the pastoral is somehow tied to this Tatiana compound. And I'll play that for you now. So right there at the very top, the Svireli zvuk unilii prastoi, and that's in the duet, which in its essence is very evocative and very sort of, it is melancholy, but it doesn't talk about anything really related to the plot of the opera. But Tchaikovsky decided, you know, very deliberately to open it with that and to include that piece, that passage of music. And it comes up several other times in the opera. Tatiana, as I said, sits down to write this letter declaring her love to Onegin. And in that particular scene, at one point she says that I turn over, my fate is in your hands. Sudbu mayu tibye vruchayu. And you're going to hear that. And on exactly those words, that same theme comes up. No tak bit, sabo mayo, nine ya tebile virtuin. So this compound has set up, it's a connection somehow to Tatiana's love, but obviously it's not happy. It's a very, very dark sounding theme. So you can't really call it a love theme. It's something else. And I'd be interested to hear what you think about what kind of a theme it is. The next compound has to do with the connection between Tatiana and Lienski. And there's nothing between Tatiana and Lienski. He's to be her future brother-in-law. There's no connection there. The connection that binds Tatiana and Lienski is their connection to Onegin and the fact that he, not necessarily intentionally, but will very much hurt them both. He will break Tatiana's heart and he will literally kill Lienski. And the connection that happens there is also on another theme. Again, from Tatiana's letter scene, there's a moment when she asks, are you my guardian angel or some sort of depraved tempter? And on those very lines, she sets up this sequence of a theme, which is then modulated slightly into another theme that is sung by Lienski later on. But let me first play the theme that I'm talking about from Tatiana's letter scene. So that's that descending line that I'm talking about. So we jump ahead, as I said, Onegin and Lienski get into an argument. Lienski challenges Onegin to a duel. And in the scene in the opera, he and his second arrive to the duel before Onegin. Onegin is actually very late and shows up with his manservant rather than a proper gentleman as his second. Showing just how little concern he has for the whole proceedings. But before Onegin shows up, Lienski sings what is often called his farewell to life. As I mentioned in the novel, this is a letter that he writes kind of to Olga or a poem. It's a little vague as to exactly what the purpose of it is. But Tchaikovsky takes that text and lifts it into essentially a beautiful aria for a tenor, which Lienski is. And what you'll hear in this particular excerpt is that same, it's not the same descending line, but it is a modification of the same descending line, which, as I'm saying, creates this Tatiana Lienski compound. And the words that he is saying are, Что день грядущий мне готовит? What does the coming day have in store for me? So he's also wondering, it's a question, just as Tatiana's letter, who are you, my guardian angel? They're both asking questions, and they're both asking questions of a man who's not interested in giving them any answer at all, and certainly not the one that they want.
Yeah.
So I'm realizing that the Что день грядущий мне готовит actually comes earlier in that aria. Toward the end there, he is making very clear, Olga, I did love you. But I'll leave that there for now. And we'll go to the next compound. Just a minute. We'll get past there. Okay, there we go. Now, the next one that I want to reveal is this Tatiana Onegin compound. And what happens here is actually quite interesting. This is a connection that Pushkin himself, interestingly, avoided. And perhaps the idea was that he saw them as just complete opposites and so different that he didn't really want any reader or anyone to consider that there really was ever a true connection between the two. But what Tchaikovsky does is, there's a moment in Tatiana's letter again, where she says, let me die, but first, you know, let me experience love. And it's a very big dramatic sound, and I'll play it for you in just a moment. It's a completely different tone from the other part of the letter writing scene that I just played. Several scenes, and essentially at least one act or two acts later, when Onegin decides to pledge his love after seeing Tatiana at the ball, he actually repeats the same melody, and although on a slightly different musical sequence, he even says the same words, Пускай погибну я, но прежде, let me die but first. And he says, Я пью волшебный яд, which are words that means I drink the magical poison. And he never says those words in Pushkin. That's a very sort of dramatic, I guess maybe romantic thing. And Pushkin's Onegin is very much sort of a cold-hearted society man, not interested in romanticism at all. That's more Linsky's thing. Anyway, so I'll play these two examples for you and at least see if you agree with the connection of those two musical ideas. So here's again, Tatiana singing her part of the Let Me Die, But First. So we get that theme and then the return of the initial Tatiana compound that comes in there. Now let's hear how it comes out when Onegin does it after having already killed Linsky in the duel, wandered around for a while, come back to St. Petersburg, met Tatiana at the ball, and now it's his turn to feel unrequited love. Уви сомнения нет, люблю я, люблю как мальчик, а не страсти умой. Пускай погибну я на прежде, я в ослепительной надежде. Вкушу волшебный яд желаний, упьюсь несбыточной мечтой, везде, везде. So I find it extremely interesting that Tchaikovsky does this. This is not something that he borrows at all from Pushkin. He borrows the words from Tatiana's scene, but not from any part of what Onegin does write a letter, as you may have seen in the other word document. But the words in his letter are very different from Tatiana's. So it's interesting that Tchaikovsky brings those two together in that way. And then this last one, as I'm calling, is the Onegin-Lenski compound, although it's not really a musical theme in the same as the other one. But the compound here is the specific way in which Tchaikovsky sets up the sequence of scenes. Because, as I said, when in the novel, when Lenski writes his sort of farewell to life, it's a letter. Onegin doesn't hear it. Really, no one does. It's a very private sort of thing. But he sings it here as part of the opera. And because immediately after this, what happens is we're setting up for the duel, Lenski ends up singing these words. And right after he sings them, the person who walks in is Onegin. And the words are, Zhelani druk, pridi, pridi, zhelani dvuk, druk, pridi ya tvoy supruk. Desired friend, please come, please come. I am your spouse, essentially. And right after he sings those words, who comes onto the stage but Onegin? And then they sing a duet. And there's a filmed version of this, a Soviet filmed version of this, where the duet itself becomes this montage of all the fun things that they've done, almost like a meet cute in a romantic comedy, which is very strange. But it shows some sort of a connection, whether you want to call it a romantic friendship or whatever, that at least Tchaikovsky sensed between Onegin and Lenski. So let's just hear Zhelani drug pridi ya tvoy supruk. Come, my desired friend, I am your spouse. Okay. Past here. There we go. All right. So those are the musical compounds that I think draw the characters together especially closely in Tchaikovsky's opera in a way that just doesn't really exist in the same way in Pushkin's original. And I think it just adds an amazing richness to the experience of the opera, especially if you are listening for those themes. So the next time you get a chance, I do want you to try to do that. The next thing I'm going to talk about is, again, this is something of my own idea, but I you can tell me whether you think it has merit or not. So I've already mentioned this pastoral motif that's in the opera. And one of the things that is very big, as I said, it's a central moment in the novel in verse is this dream that Tatiana has. And there's no dream sequence in the opera at all. So as I say, it's seemingly absent. But the thing that comes up both in the dream and in the opera is this notion of panpipes. And in the opera, we have this thing called a pliaska, which is a dance. It's also sometimes called a charavot, which probably in English is closest to a roundelay. It's a circle dance that is sung by a chorus. And this happens in the opera. But first I want to do, so we've already talked about the Slicha Livui, have you heard? This actually, I think I've dwelt on this enough. So in the poem, in the novel in verse, there's a fortune-telling sequence. Tatiana falls asleep after this. And Lel, who is a Russian pagan god, hovers over Tatiana. and she dreams of crossing a bridge, which is glued together by ice with two thin poles. She's then pursued by a bear, and there's a feast where all the guests are monsters, and Onegin is the host. And Tatiana is sitting very close on a bench with Onegin. Olga, in a strange fit of jealousy, because she's not jealous of Tatiana at all, bursts in with Lansky. And Onegin snatches a long knife, which he kills. He stabs Lansky with it, and Lansky is killed in this dream. Now, all of that happens, of course, when Tatiana is asleep. She's in a nightshirt, obviously. And when she wakes up from the dream, this little sequence happens here. It says, her little voice could be heard more tenderly than the refrain of a panpipe. What is your name? A shepherd is walking by. He looks at her and he answers, Agafon, which a lot of Russians would probably have laughed at because this shepherd has this very old classical name. But Pushkin says, this is a footnote he adds, it was by this very means that the name of the future husband would be found out. And so this is the text of Tchaikovsky's Haravot or Plaska, the chorus. There's actually at the very beginning of the opera, there are two choruses. One is a more sort of solemn chorus, and then Tatiana's mother actually says, oh, this was kind of sad. Can you sing something a little more merry? And so a lot of people just look at this as a chorus that goes by, and it is very fun and loud and all those things. And I'm going to play it for you in just a minute. But my argument is that there are so many elements in this chorus that are reminiscent of the dream sequence, and that in my opinion, they sort of stand in. And what we have are the Mastu Mostochku, the little bridge. So she crosses a little bridge, and it's made of snowball wood. The connection to the frozenness. And there are all these very, very sort of sexual images, which is not uncommon for folk imagery. You've got something that's like a berry and a stout stick. And she is, she is supposed to be asleep. The sun is set. Are you still awake? Sorry, let me go back to this view instead. So what you'll hear though when I do play it is all of these words. Okay, we'll do it this way. Anyway, my point is that the dream has all of these elements in it. And this seemingly very simple, very fun little folk song goes in these rather same directions, but with a very, very different sound. Okay, so now that we've heard the beginning of it, I'll now play the whole thing for you. And you can sort of watch. There is a moment when I cut it a little bit short, but I figured this was a good thing to sort of come to a close with, because it is a chorus, and you are a chorus. And perhaps one of these days you'll actually want to perform this, because it's really quite a zinger. So here we go. Oh, that, we come to the end of the dream and all of the compounds, and I'll be happy to take any questions you may have about what you've heard today.
I actually have two questions. This is Helen.
Yes.
I just saw Onegin three times in the last 5 months in the Met streaming, two different productions, you know, three times. Anyway, and I noticed this is just an interesting comment. I never really understood what they were saying in that chorus, but my reaction to this latest production was that, the dance was so rough with the girl. I mean, it looked kind of like a gang rape, honestly. Mm. And I thought it was rather objectionable. But now I'm kind of seeing what they were interpreting, you know, right. maybe they were reading the words. So that's kind of interesting. And then the question I have is, you mentioned like in the end, in the poem, that Onegin just kind of accepted it. And in the opera, there's this big scene where he's really passionately and on his knees and trying everything he can to get her back. Is that sort of special for the opera, or?
Well, it's logical to assume. Right. Yeah. No, it's logical to assume that that kind of thing must happen. But the reality is that Pushkin just says, well, I'm going to stop it here. You can probably guess what happens next. I mean, he just leaves it very, you know, completely unresolved. And it feels sort of very modern in that sense, where it's like, suddenly, wait a minute, am I the reader? Am I the person who's supposed to make this up? You know, what's going on? But you know, like I said, Tchaikovsky couldn't leave that for other people. And originally, actually, it had different words. He said something like, oh, my life is miserable. Oh, death, I go to seek you out. And instead, he finally changed it to Pazor Taska Ojalki Zhrevi Moi, which I also find a really, really strong tying together of all of the characters, because the Pazor is probably like Lenski, you know, because he had that sort of disgraceful moment with him. But Tosca is obviously Tatiana, because that's her whole milieu, is being sad. Pazor is disgrace, Tosca is sadness or grief. And then Ojalki Zhrebi Moi is just Onegin. Pitiful, Zhrebi actually has to do with tossing of the dice, my pitiful lot. And so it's less dramatic and romantic as the, oh, death, I go to seek you out. But I think it says a lot more about the characters and the way that Tchaikovsky felt about the three of them.
Yeah. It's very interesting.
I have a question. I'm Susan.
Hi, Susan.
I was reading a little bit about the opera before this evening, and I read that the opera was premiered at the Moscow Conservatory of Music.
Yes.
With students. I thought that was unusual. This seems to be a very mature opera. Why was it done at the Moscow Conservatory rather than with more mature singers?
Well, Tchaikovsky was a little concerned that the opera wouldn't be understood, and he was absolutely right about it. A lot of people, one of the biggest complaints, and actually it's a fairly famous one, the writer Turgenev saw it performed in France when it had already become somewhat well known. And he just thought, what a strange thing to have ordinary people in regular clothes and a general on the stage in his uniform. Everything just seemed so sort of quotidian, which for opera just seemed completely out of place. And it was exactly what Tchaikovsky wanted to do. And so he believed actually that if the opera were going to gain success, that it would get to be known sort of in small, maybe home, or people had their own theaters, especially larger families, and a lot of people did singing at home as well, of course. So he believed that that was the way that it would become popular. Another thing that's unusual about this opera, with at least in its own time, is that even the singing reminded most Russians less of opera and more of something called romance, which is the Russian equivalent almost of Lieder in German. The kind of music that is written for piano and designed for home performance. Despite the fact that, you know, there are some big moments, of course, but a lot of people actually complained about that. And Tchaikovsky knew that. He didn't do it accidentally. It's not like he didn't know what he was doing. He wrote the the opera precisely for that reason. There are actually a number of songs that he wrote around the same time that bear amazing resemblance to the opera itself. There's one called Strashnaya Minuta, the terrifying minute, that almost absolutely mimics the moment when Tatiana is confronted by Onegin after the letter writing scene, and she's just utterly humiliated. The song is like the minute just before that, before the humiliation happens. But that was, it's a song entirely unrelated to Onegin, but I think all of these ideas were constantly informing him. You know, bearing in mind that the novel is from, like I said, roughly the 1830s, when Russia was just different from how it was in the 1870s. I hope that explains something.
I actually have a follow-on question to that, and that is, how did audiences react differently to the novel and opera, and what does that say? Does that say something about their respective historical eras?
It says a little bit of something about their respective historical eras. Again, as I said, I mean, when Pushkin wrote the novel, there were probably fewer than 20 to 25% of Russians who ordinarily read in Russian. The educated people in Russia tended to read either French or German. There's a moment in the novel, which Tchaikovsky doesn't deal with, where Pushkin, he actually says that this letter that she writes wasn't written in Russian, that she wrote it in French, because she wouldn't have known Russian well enough to write it in French. And so that affects the reception of Onegin a little bit, because it was this strange, somewhat strange thing in Russian society in the 1820s for something to come out and be taken very seriously in the Russian language, at least anything that wasn't sort of an ode to, you know, the emperor or something like that. Pushkin and a lot of other people around him, and some a little bit before, were more or less creating Russian literature on the spot. As a result, and not because it didn't deserve it, but as a result, it has this kind of foundational place in Russian literature. So by the time we get to Tchaikovsky, it was a little bit like, I don't know what to really compare it to. Somebody having the gall to, people have set Shakespeare to music, obviously. But it just, people didn't really believe that it was appropriate for Tchaikovsky to do it, because it was just so beloved and so well known. And so it took a while, but I would say now, if you ask most Russians, you know, they'll say, what do you believe is the greatest Russian opera? I think it'd be fair to say that many of them would say it's Eugene Onegin. Although, an interesting little sidebar there, if you asked them to sing something from Eugene Onegin, they would probably sing the aria, by, Tatiana's husband, and it's Onegin yaskrivat nestanu bezumno ya lyublu Tatianu. This was even quoted in a play by Chekhov, a farce. And the amazing thing is that those are lines that are not written by Pushkin at all. Russians will think that that is a line from Pushkin's Eugene Onegin, but it's actually exclusively from the opera. So in a way, despite sort of some resistance to the opera at the time that it appeared, it has in some ways supplanted Pushkin, at least in popular understanding of the story. I would defer, of course, to Irina or any of the others for what they think of that opinion.
I just wanted to say that I worked on that aria. It's exquisite.
It is an exquisite aria, you're absolutely right.
It absolutely stands out like something very special.
Yes, you're absolutely right. Part of the text, I will also say, part of that text was published in the Pushkin novel, but it was published sort of in the footnotes as something that he decided to leave out, possibly because it gave a little bit too much personality to Tatiana's husband. He doesn't even really have, I don't think he has a name, in the novel. In the opera, he's called Gremin. And so everybody knows him, and you know, there's all sorts of different representations of that character. I saw a bunch of different productions of it when I was in Russia at one point. And, you know, he was called an old fat general. I think that's the only thing that Pushkin says about him. And in one production, he was presented on stage like in a wheelchair, which was just a little bit too much. You're like, why would, anyway. But yeah, that is a real banger of an aria. It's beautiful. The text is lovely. Although, as I said, a lot of it, I think, might actually have been written by Tchaikovsky himself. He worked with a gentleman named Shilovsky on the libretto in the early days, but he threw out almost everything that was from Shilovsky and replaced it either with Pushkin or with much of his own material.
Hi, John. It's John Mark.
Hi.
While we're on Tatiana at the end, I'm trying to get a sense of where she winds up.
she winds up with her husband.
Yes, but is she still in love, or is she jaded, or where is she?
Well, that's a very interesting question, especially for those who have seen the production with Nitrepka and Chorostovsky that was at the Met. Because I have, much as I like both of those singers and the production overall, I objected to the way they dealt with that on the stage. Actually, I'm sorry, that wasn't Nitrepka, it was Renee Fleming. Because they have this scene where they're practically just all over each other, very much kissing and touching and holding. And like I said, in Pushkin, that does not happen. They have a rather cold conversation about his feelings and her basically saying, well, that would have been nice a few years ago, but I'm married now. So, you know, on your way. Yes, I do still love you, but none of it is done with great passion. None of it is done with a sense of turning back time and, you know, oh, if only we could, you know, running away with each other or something. That is not even on the table, nowhere close. But Tchaikovsky changes that. He makes it into a more romantic scene. But I do think he would not have expected the two characters to actually embrace or kiss, even the way he has it set up.
So it's more of a platonic or almost a...
Well, no, I mean, I think Tatiana was madly in love with Onegin.
Was, yes.
And then he breaks her heart. She never forgets it. You don't ever forget your first love.
Yeah.
But, you know, she knows that he's, you know, a player. And that, you know, as much as she may still love him, there's no real future with him. And I think his feelings at that moment are also very true. I mean, that's what makes the novel really compelling, is that you have all of these, you know, loves kind of at cross purposes, and they never quite come together. So everybody ends up kind of just miserable.
Well, I think it somewhat works that he gets rejected at the end.
I'm sorry?
I think, let me undo my mind.
He is, yes. Yeah, she essentially rejects him.
Yeah.
She does admit, yes, I may still love you, but it doesn't matter. You know, we've all moved on.
Yeah.
I have a question.
I'm
is
sorry?
Is there time for another question?
Sure.
I'm looking at Onegin's character and trying to read the text closely. I hope this is lifted from Pushkin. He says, he's basically rejecting her, and he says, "Я вас люблю брата," I like love you like a brother. And then he says, and maybe, может быть, еще сильнее?
Yes, maybe just
and
a little stronger than
that. He thinks about that for a while. And he changes it. He says, maybe Yeshua Nizhne, which is the tenth word.
Yes.
So isn't he thinking about the relationship that he could have had, the actual authentic relationship that he could have had with her, and looking back in anguish?
Well, so yes, that text is from Pushkin. Although the shift from Silnye to Nizhnye, I think that's exclusive to Tchaikovsky. And that's another lovely aria, actually, in the opera. But no, my feeling is that Onegin thinks it's absurd that this young girl, and there are arguments about just how young she is, but this young, inexperienced girl to actually be in love with him, he finds that completely absurd. it's not even something he would even think about. And it's mostly because she's just a provincial girl. She's very young. Some people guess that she might've been as young as 15 or maybe even 14. But that's never fully stated. It sort of depends on what you believe was normal, you know, for that kind of interaction in the provinces in Russia at that time. But she's definitely, you know, a schoolgirl essentially. And so, you know, he's a grown man and he just finds it absurd, maybe even inappropriate. He doesn't say that. He just says, you know, oh, you know, you're nice, but you'll thank me one day for turning you down.
So what is Signe?
Signe is stronger.
Ah.
Perhaps Signe, yeah. It's really Signe, yeah, but it's shortened to Signe. And then Nizhne is more tender.
Mm. If I may just add one more I don't know, color to this, is that words like tender up until fairly recently not necessarily have the romantic or sexual subtext. They just didn't. They could completely be used in a completely non-romantic mm-hmm. environment, like a friendship between, you know, between two men or two women, again, having yes. really zero of that tension.
That's a good point.
John, this has been great. I think we're all glad that in real life, love is never this complicated, right, everyone?
And I do wish the musical examples had not been so complicated. I'm sorry that was playing. I don't have full control over PowerPoint in a Zoom presentation yet, but I hope it was enjoyable.
I think we all just learned a lot. It was a wonderful deep dive into multiple dimensions of this piece. I think we're all in your debt, John. So thank you.
Yeah, just really great. Wonderful.